Good afternoon, everyone. I almost said good morning, but that too, okay? We'll add that. Well, it's a great day, except I didn't realize, I thought it was going to be a little cooler today, but I don't think so. Just because the wind's blowing doesn't mean it's cool outside. So you got to watch that today. Make sure you're hydrating yourself. Right? Right. Okay. Well, your announcements today, if you look at the back of your bulletin, we finish up our episode 3 today in Chosen Bible Study after church, and then we'll have to wait for episode 4 coming out. Season. Thank you. Whatever that is, the word, season. So, but we're excited because they are doing a 4, season 4, so that will be fun. And I'm sure it seems like it's been improving each time. And so I think 4 will be an amazing, amazing time. So when we get to that point, maybe more of you will join us. It's been really a good study. Thank you, Kathy and Gail, her cohort there. Worship design is August 1st at 10, so anyone wanting to help us with worship, you're sure welcome to come. This Tuesday, that's right, because tomorrow's the last day of July. Woo! What? Oh, the date? Well, they're going by too fast. Sometimes you don't keep track of them. The other big thing, though, this week is Ernie Couch and his revival coming here on the 3rd at 6 o'clock. And I know that for some of you men, I don't know, Janet, did we talk about, we've talked about coming an hour early or something for that? I know we, yeah. Yeah, the council will be here at 4 talking about a program that the pastor wants us to look at for our church. And so hopefully we can help out, but okay. All right. Because usually last year they had us come, it was like a couple hours, but I don't think it took that long. But they set up their stage, and so at least it would be nice to have some help here maybe an hour before for carrying in their equipment and helping them out there. I'd say around 5. Yeah, I would say around 5, any of you could. You know, because I know that they have some really cool stuff that they work with. So it's going to be pretty professional, or not pretty, it is professional. So it'd be nice if you tell your neighbors and invite them to come with you, because it'll be a nice production to see. Worship in the Park is going to be the 13th, and we start at 11, we'll go to about 3 o'clock, and Strings Attached will be here. That will be exciting at the park. And the church is going to buy the chicken, so you want to bring all your other side dishes that you'd like to make, and we'll partake in a meal and then enjoy some games together. And visit and have fellowship and then have our church, but string is attached, will play throughout that time. So that will be great. Any other announcements today? I can't think of, okay.
Didn't we have to have like some water and stuff back there for Ernie and his group?
Yeah,
and
usually, last time it was sort of funny because we had set up the choir room for them because it, you know, dressing and everything. And then I think they went to the nursery room and did it there, but nobody was back there. But we need to do that, yeah. So water, and I think Jana has that covered, but.
And, well, what?
Okay, she has that list that.
Oh, okay. My thought is we had a clothes rack in there, and now they're all in the Sunday school room.
Okay, we could maybe move one in there just in case they need to hang something up.
That's what I was thinking. Thank you.
I don't think they did very many costume changes, but I don't remember. It's, you know, 2 years is a little too long for this brain to remember. So, yeah. But, you know, it was such an amazing concert 2 years ago. And of course, COVID was messing us up. So we had very few people here. And it was really a shame because they were wonderful. And now he's bringing his grandson, who looks pretty young, but is the other guy that's in the picture is his son. So it should be wonderful. So please come. I'm not seeing any other announcements. We're okay? All right. Worship.
All right, before we start the call to worship, I just want to give you a little bit of a background on the resources that we're going to be using today. I'm leaning heavily on an author called Kate Bowler. She was raised as a Mennonite in Canada, and then she came to America, and she went to Duke Divinity School, and she got her degree in religion. And as part of that, she studied prosperity theology. And in prosperity theology, if you are right with God, God will bless you. And if you are not right with God, bad things will happen to you. And so in that theology, in that way of thinking, if bad things are happening to you, God is angry with you. So she got to be close with people in that way of thinking as she studied them. And then she got to be an associate dean in divinity, at Duke Divinity. And she and her husband had a beautiful baby boy. And it looked like life was great. And then she was diagnosed in her mid-30s with stage 4 colon cancer. And she wrote a book called Everything Happens for a Reason and Other Lies I've Loved. And she wrote that in response to that group of people that she thought were her friends who turned their backs on her because they thought that God was punishing her. And then she was enrolled in an experimental treatment program, and she was one of the very few people in her cohort who survived. And so she wrote a second book called There's No Cure for Being Human and Other Truths I Needed to Hear. And so our call to worship today is going to come from the lives we actually have, and it's 100 blessings for imperfect days. And so if you will stand and join me, we're going to follow along with Kate. Lord, here I am. How strange it is. Canes, and others like glassy seas, and others like nothing much at all. Today is a cosmic shrug. Day planner says, rather conveniently, that I will not need you, cry for you, reach for you. Ordinarily, I might not think of you at all. Except if you don't mind, let me notice you. Show up in the small necessities and everyday graces. God, be bread, be water, be laundry. Be the coffee cup in my hands and the reason to calm down in traffic. Be the gentler tone in my insistence today that people pick up after themselves for once. Be the reason I feel loved when I catch my own reflection or feel my own self-loathing fluttering in my stomach. Calm my mind, lift my spirit, make this dumb, ordinary day my prayer of thanks. And now we'll sing Come the Font. Nope, we're going to do Joys and Concerns. Sorry, Renee is going to.
Well, let's share our joys and concerns today. What joys do you have? What concerns do we need to pray about?
This is about Mom.
Oh.
She's going to be 88 years old on Monday, August 3rd. Ha!
Oh.
And she's really doing good. And she's gotten through the infusions. And she's just...
You're just thank spunky, you, Lord. Aren't you? Oh, her... All right. So she has family coming in from West... Chicago, Illinois. All right. So the third, see, we can celebrate at Couch's concert too. Yeah. But any other birthdays so that we can sing happy birthday to Miss Gail as well? Anybody else? Nobody wants to raise your hand, do you? All right. Let's sing happy birthday to Gail today. I'd like to say it's a joy that my grandchildren will be starting school, but I don't think they think that way. But schools are going to be starting, and I think we need to raise up our schools and teachers and administrators up to the Lord, because things change and things are changing, and they need our prayers. They need God for sure. So, well... I know that on Friday, a dear lady in our congregation is going to have a pacemaker put in, and she, I'm sure, would love to have you lift her up in prayer, but she wouldn't share that, and I'll probably get the glare that I shouldn't be sharing it. But Norma needs your prayers on Friday. She's going to do great, and it's going to help that old ticker. She'll be running around here better than she's ever done, so woohoo! And she's hoping for that. So please lift her up for Friday when she has her pacemaker put in. I know that's always a concern of any time when you have to have surgery. And my mom is doing fairly well with her new tube in her kidney and whatever, but she always needs your prayers if you would keep her in your prayers. It's not fun getting old, she tells me. And I said, I know, Mom, I'm already experiencing some things. So, but please lift her up too. Any others that we need to lift up? All right. You guys are quiet today. I'm never quiet. So. So I guess I do the talking for you, John. All right. Well, the dear Lord is always with us, and I know where two or more are gathered in his name. He's here, right here with us and listening to our prayers, and he does take our prayers in his hands, and he deals with them in our best interest. So with that, let's pray. Almighty Father, you are so good to us. We praise you for this beautiful day and for all of the things happening in the fields right now. There's so much with the harvest time coming and all the good things that start in the fall with school and just things that happen in our world to keep life going. We praise you for all of those things, for all the farmers and for all of the wonderful gifts they give to us each and every day. We thank you too, Lord, for our country, America. We lift up our military and we lift up our leaders at all levels that you can be with them to make the right decision for us. We also thank you for all of our congregation and the members that have gone through some real hard times, but we know that you're with us, and those that will be going through surgeries coming up. We just ask for your blessing and for traveling mercies for everyone, too, that perhaps are still trying to enjoy the summer before the fall begins. We thank you for this time that Cindy has prepared a wonderful service for us, and we praise you for that. And we are so grateful that she has that talent to share her wonderful ways with you. We thank you, Lord, for all that you do for us, for this church, for our community, communities that surround us, and for all the good that we try to do for you. I ask for your wisdom, Lord, and guidance in the upcoming decisions about Messy Church and for the couch concert, and also for our outdoor church with the strings attached. We thank you for their music and the talents that they share with us. And we pray that others will come so they can also take in your word through their music as well as through their words. We praise you, Father, for everything. It's only through you that we are able to do the things we do. And we ask for your continued guidance on the right path to do your will and not our own. We ask, too, that we may be better disciples for you. And Jesus taught his disciples when they asked him how to pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father,
stand if you want. Thank you.
So the message for today is from Scripture, is from Luke 22 through 28. And he continued teaching his disciples, "Don't fuss about what's on the table at mealtime or the clothes that are in your closet, if they're in fashion. There is far more to your inner life than the food you put in your stomach, more to your outer appearance than the clothes you hang on your body. Look at the ravens, free and unfettered, not tied down to a job description, carefree in care of God, and you count far more. Has anyone by fussing before the mirror ever gotten as much as an inch taller? If fussing can't do that, why fuss at all? Walk in the fields, look at the wildflowers. They don't fuss with their appearance, but have you ever seen color and design quite like it? The 10 best dressed men and women look shabby alongside them. If God gives such attention to the wildflowers, most of them never even seen, don't you think he'll attend to you? Take pride in you. Do his best for you." May God add his blessings to the words.
Going with delights. So I'm going to read what the message I'm bringing you today comes from Kate Bowler, from her book Good Enough, 40-ish Devotions for a Life of Imperfection. And in her devotions, we have a little bit of scripture, and then there's a message, and then there's a blessing, and then there's a challenge. So if you thought you were going to get out of this, you're not. I had Dave read the scripture, and he read it from the message because it's a very familiar scripture, right? We all know about the birds and the lilies in the field. And so it's a little different when he reads that version. I'm going to read the version that you're a little more familiar with. "Consider the ravens. They do not sow or reap. They have no storeroom or barn, and yet God feeds them. And how much more valuable are you than the birds? Who of you, by worrying, can add a single hour to your life? Since you cannot do this very little thing, why do you worry about the rest? Consider how the wildflowers grow. They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you, not even Solomon, in all of his splendor, who was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today, and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, how much more will he clothe you, you of little faith? Jesus explains that even the lilies and the grass of the fields are clothed, and the birds of the air are cared for. So how much more will God care for you? It's a lovely thought when taken at face value. But we all know that birds fall from the sky or fly into windows. Lilies shrivel up. Grass withers and dies. What reassurance may Jesus be offering then? It's not our infinity that Jesus promises, but God's attentiveness. No matter what is keeping you up at night or what feels overwhelming, God has not left your side. God sees you. God has not forgotten you. God is awake. No reason whatsoever. Our culture says that everything has to be for something. Reading is for self-improvement. Hobbies are for enrichment. Didn't you know your child or grandchild's soccer practice is a long-haul attempt to get a better college application? Your crappy watercolor painting has to hang in the living room, or else that afternoon was a waste. Didn't you know you're supposed to be getting better all the time? It's called hyper-specialized. That one. We're going to substitute hyper-specialized. The obsession with use. It's a symptom of the pragmatism that has wound its way into every part of the American culture. How useful was your day? When our lives get overwhelming, it's tempting to begin to use this logic as a weapon against ourselves. Look at us, failing to multitask, failing to render all goods into ideas and practices and moments that can be useful. And if you read yesterday's paper, there was a column that was written by a high school senior who just graduated, and it talks about all of this right there. If you can, get online or pick it up and read it. It might seem counterintuitive then that when life is at its worst, I don't turn to doing nothing. Naps and television and sitting around are great. But when a week is full of terrible appointments, or when I can't seem to get out of an anxious thought loop, I need something to do when life feels so out of control. I remember really vividly this one terrible week when I went from the medical hellscape to a work trip. It sounds horrible, but I took an approach that taught me a really important lesson, and here it is. You can find incredible peace and joy when you discover you are doing something for no reason at all. Did I help skin an elk for an indigenous studies class? Yes, yes, I did. Lots of strong shoulder work. Did I go visit the world's largest Ukrainian sausage? I sure did. I learned how to make spritzels something or others because my old college roommate is obsessed with German cookie making. And I watched a soloist hammer out the chords on her guitar in a park like she didn't care if any person on planet wanted to follow her on Twitter. I have always said that I don't have hobbies. I have friends. And maybe I don't need to be bird watching much on the side, but I do need to cultivate a habit that my friends have already figured out. Just trying feels so good. When the stakes are low, you can return to the beautiful stupidity of caring. My husband plays defense on an intramural hockey league because when he tried out, he was one of the only people who could skate backward. And she puts in parentheses, I wish I could explain to non-Canadians, and for me growing up in northern Minnesota, to all of you non-Minnesotans, how funny that really is. But he plays because he likes the way it feels to rack up penalty points. My friend Will was recently found in his garage using a saw to cut out a wooden snake because he decided his house was missing something. Wooden snakes. So maybe today you need permission to do something for no reason whatsoever. Just like God takes care of the birds and the lilies in the field. Bake the cookies your great aunt used to make, even if they don't turn out perfectly. Read a poem out loud with a fake Swedish accent. I will spare you. Lie in the grass and form cloud animals, or dream up new constellations. Take a drive to the nearest roadside attraction, and she wants you to report back. Take up whittling or learn to cross-stitch an inappropriate saying onto a pillow. Remember, we're not aiming for perfect. We're just trying to remember to ask ourselves, how does it feel to try? And this is a blessing for finding delight in a difficult day. Blessed are you when life has handed you yet another serious mess. Instead of turning straight to worry or despair or fear or dread, you just set it down for a minute and say, I'll get to that later. I've got something ridiculous to do, and it's urgent. Blessed are you who do something you've never tried that must be done right now, because failing doesn't matter. You know that it just feels so good to try. Blessed are we, the responsible, who take a non-linear path, who, as the poet Wendell Berry says, every day do something that won't compute, who know that when life gets heavy or hard or too much, we must carve a path to delight, who do something for no reason whatsoever, but for joy. Blessed are you who see the art in absurdity, because when you think about it, life is unexpectedly and terribly and wonderfully absurd. So why don't we just embrace it? So blessed are you when you grow too many tomatoes of more than one variety, or solve a mystery while playing interactive glow-in-the-dark miniature golf, or learn a new dance, or create a band out of kitchen instruments, or make a cake that looks like the Leaning Tower of Pisa. But you can only name it that way afterwards. This is only the beginning. And her good enough step, this is your challenge. You know it's coming. It's your turn to do something for no reason whatsoever, like learning another language to find the words that don't exist in English. After all, why is there a word in German that means a face badly in need of a fist? Or in Brazilian Portuguese, a tiny little word that means tenderly running your fingers through your lover's hair. I don't know. But how great is that trivia? Finger paint with water on a sidewalk. Learn the alphabet backwards. It'll help if you ever get stopped. Make up new names for all of the plants you can see. I mean, obviously, dandelions would be better named puff buzzers. Pick something, anything, that may seem like a colossal waste of time. But it matters, because it makes you smile. So, we're going to have a song, and I think I've had you guys listen to it before. It's by Carrie Newcomer, and it's just kind of that finding joy in the everyday, holy as the day is spent.
Holy is the dish and drain, The soap and sink and the cup and plate, the warm wool socks and the cold white tie, shower heads and good dry towels, and frying eggs sound like songs, with bits of salt measured in my palm. And it's all a part of a sacrament as holy as a day you spent. Holy is the busy street, the cars that boom with passion's beat, and the checkout girl counting and change, the hands that shook my hands today, and hymns of peace fly overhead and spread their wings like their parents did. Blessed be the dog that runs in her sleep to chase some wild and elusive thing. Holy is the familiar room, quiet moments in the afternoon, and folding sheets like folding hands to pray as only laundry can. I'm letting go of all my fear, like autumn leaves made of earth and air, but the summer came and the summer went, as holy as a day is spent. Holy is the place I stand to give whatever small good I can, and the empty page, the open book, redemption everywhere I look. Unknowingly we slow our pace, shade of unexpected grace, and with grateful smiles and sad lament, as holy as a day is spent. And morning light sings providence, as holy as a day is spent.
And as part of our holy, as a day is spent today, we're going to take an offering now. Thank you. Now let us pray. Thank you, God, for giving us a world filled with delights, if we will but pay attention. We have days that shimmer and days worn dull by obligations. Help us to bless these days, these gifts, these moments that you give us, as Carrie Newcomer does in her poem, Three Gratitudes. Every night before I go to sleep, I say out loud three things that I'm grateful for. All the significant, insignificant, extraordinary, ordinary stuff of my life. It's a small practice and humble, and yet I find I sleep better, holding what lightens and softens my life ever so briefly at the end of the day. Sunlight and blueberries, good dogs and wool socks, a fine rain, a good friend, fresh basil and wild phlox, my father's good health, my daughter's new job, the song that always makes me cry, always at the same part, no matter how many times I hear it. Decent coffee at the airport, and your quiet breathing, the stories you told me, the frost patterns on the windows, English horns and banjos, wood thrush and June bugs, the smooth, glassy calm of the morning pond, an old coat, a new poem, my library card, and that my car keeps running despite all the miles. And after three things, more often than not, I get on a roll and I just keep on going. I keep naming and listing until I lie grinning, blankets pulled up to my chin, awash with the wonder of it all, at the sweetness of it all. Amen. And of course, you knew I wasn't going to let you out of here without singing Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee.
Thank you.
So your benediction is going to come from Kate Bowler's 100 Blessings for Imperfect Days. And blessings are a conversation you're having with God. It's a way to put something in place. It's not God giving you something. It's you giving back to God, too. And so it's blessing number 80, for learning to delight again. And she starts with a quote, "Joy is a mystery because it can happen anywhere, anytime, even under the most unpromising circumstances, even in the midst of suffering with tears in your eyes." And that came from Frederick Buchner. And here is the blessing. "Blessed are you, the pragmatic, you who have run the math and know what adds up and what doesn't. You have set it all down. You don't hope or dream or plan anymore. What's the point? Your world has shrunk. Pain or grief or fear has sucked up every bit of oxygen from the room, and every ounce of delight has been squeezed from your hands. Blessed are you learning to live here in this unrecognizable, unnameable place. Blessed are you who discover that even in the smallness, your attention might be compressed even more. You pull out a magnifying glass to discover, to notice, to taste, to smell, the small joys and simple pleasures that make a life worth living. You who wear the fancy blouse because it makes you feel nice, long after you thought your body wasn't worth decorating. You who eat the over-the-top meal because that is what today can afford. You who make a memory and plan the trip and snap a picture because you know that this one wild, precious life might cost you everything. So why not make it not just bearable, but beautiful? So go forth this week and make it a beautiful, wild, delightful week. Amen. And now you guys can sit down because I'm going to make you sad. So we're going to look really quick. It's going to be hard to read. Clarence has already assured me that I made it too small. So it's going to be hard to read. We're going to put it in the newsletter. This goes out through the end of May in the newsletter with great hope. I'll have through the end of June. But what we've got, and so you can look at it for real and see it. We've got actual January to May, actual expenses on the left, and then what we had in the budget. You'll see that we're running pretty close on giving. When we did the budget in January, we only had estimated giving. I didn't have other giving, UMCOR apportionments or property. Some people give just directly to property maintenance. So if you look at total income at $31,360, a little under half, and since we're 5 months into the year, that's pretty good. We're right on track. We are still continuing to deposit $300 a month. You can roll down, Clarence. $300 a month into the maintenance savings account. You know, pastoral salary, pension, and health are right on track for where we should be. We're pretty close to on track with utilities, what we budgeted for cleaning. Insurance, we're right in there. Office, compensation and taxes, we're pretty close to right in there, maybe a little under. Office expenses, we're right in there. Property maintenance, we had had issues with the ceiling leaking, so we had to fix the ceiling. We had a few other things that we weren't expecting. That's why property maintenance is a wee bit up there. Worship expense, we're doing really good at not spending any money on that. And apportionments, we had committed to paying $1,200 this year, $100 a month, and we're running ahead on that. And the apportionments are what we give back to the general church. That's what helps us have a pastor, do annual conference. So expenses over income, we are running about $4,800 in the red, but remember we budgeted that we were going to run about $6,400, almost $6,500 in the red. We knew that going into the year, so we're not doing too bad. Outreach, that $565, that comes through Tiny Pettigrove's estate had a line item to use for outreach, and that's what we're using for that. So that's coming from dedicated. I will tell you, as your lay delegate to annual conference, one of the items was to increase pastoral compensation significantly. There was a move to try and do it in phases for small churches. That was defeated. So we're running about where we expected this year, but when we do the budget, when I show you the budget later this year for next year, it's going to be up significantly on pastoral compensation, and we don't have a choice. You guys got any questions? Otherwise, you can look at it in the newsletter. And Elaine Steele moved to Seattle, and her new address will also be in the newsletter. Awesome, guys. God bless you. Go forward and find some joy today.
Thank you, Beth, for staying. Yeah, I'm done. Thank you.